Okay, the final item of business this afternoon is the members' business debate on motion 12695 in the name of Maggie Chapman on celebrating workers and trade unions on May Day. The debate will be concluded without any questions being put. I'd invite members wishing to participate to press the request to speak buttons, and I invite Maggie Chapman to open the debate around 7 minutes. Ms Chapman.
Thank you, Presiding Officer. Today is May Day, a day for both workers and Beltane. I sometimes wonder if deep in the mists of time these 2 days are linked. Beltane and other May Day traditions marking the beginning of summer often involved rituals where an ordinary person was chosen to be a lord of misrule, someone to take the place of the lord or master to govern in their place for that day or that period. Beltane traditions were, of course, an important element of pre-modern cultures, where power couldn't be wielded in the universal way the modern state seeks to. Almost no pre-modern culture revered those in power and left them there all the time. Often, those in power were figures of fun, and not, of course, in the way a leader who lasts less long than a lettuce is a figure of fun, but structurally figures of fun. May Day has its origins, as we know it today as Workers' Day, in the Haymarket Massacre in Chicago, a massacre that came as part of a campaign for the eight-hour working day. And the campaign for the eight-hour working day has its modern equivalent in the campaign for a four-day working week. Just as the wealthy who lived off the work done by others argued that 19th century workers should be forced into 12 to 16-hour days, so the wealthy today who live off the work done by others suggest that a four-day week would be catastrophic. Of course, we know that neither is true. Fair working hours 100 years ago were good for everyone. Fair working weeks now are similarly good for everyone. But I think the roots of May Day go back beyond the campaign for an eight-hour day of 1886. So what is the link between May Day and Beltane? The action for the campaign for an eight-hour day began with a strike of industrial workers across the United States. They chose the 1st of May as the start date for their strike, and I think we can assume it was for a good reason. We are talking about an era where there is very little written evidence of what happened with working-class people, much less where those people exercised their power. Workers did not get to shape the narrative of the history we assume as fact. So what I think might have happened was that many of the lords of misrule, chosen to govern for a day, turned out to be better rulers than the authorities of the day. They turned the world upside down. They enjoyed more popularity. They reversed unfair decisions. They highlighted the often self-interested nature of power. I think it's safe to assume that this probably ended pretty badly for them when the normal order of things resumed. And we see parallels today. Structures of power, elites with vested interests in the status quo, using their power and influence to keep progressive change from rising. That is why we see public bodies still failing to pay the living wage to workers, including, to my dismay, companies owned by the Scottish Government. That is why we see too many workers still not receiving the real living wage, including workers contracted to provide public services. We have the shocking situation that maternity leave is unequal across sectors and shamefully within the public sector too. We have fair pay disputes across Moray, Fife, Dundee, West Dumbartonshire, Renfrewshire and Falkirk councils. There continue to be job evaluation issues in Glasgow and discriminatory practices used by contracting companies that deliver council services. And very directly, we have the continued refusal by the UK government and opposition to devolve employment law. If we had these powers, we might be able to go some way to creating a good example. As we face the problems of the future, we need to find ways to work together to deliver a better world. Central to that work must be our engagement with workers and their trade unions. Many of us in this chamber are long-time trade unionists, and I refer members to my register of interests. I am a member of Unite the Union. Over the last couple of weeks, there has been a festival of trade unionism in Dundee. The Speak Oot Festival of Events, while maybe not quite the appointment of a Lord of Misrule, have seen workers, activists, community organisers, campaigners and politicians from across the city and beyond, and from across many political parties, come together to debate, learn, share, celebrate and show solidarity with each other. I really enjoyed attending several events and paid tribute to the organising group for such a great festival. Over the last couple of years, I've been privileged to work closely with the Fire Brigades Union and their DECON campaign. It is only right that some of the bravest of public servants are treated properly, given the support, facilities and training they need to keep themselves safe, to clean carcinogenic toxins off their bodies, clothes and equipment while they work to save our lives and our communities. I would like to put on record again my support for the women in the FBU that are fighting for 52, for improved maternity pay within the Scottish Fire and Rescue Service, to bring our service in line with several others across the rest of the UK. And I look forward to marking with the FBU and others International Firefighters Day this coming Saturday. Trade unions, as we heard yesterday in Bill Kidd's members' debate recognising the 50th anniversary of the Health and Safety etc. at Work Act, have played a pivotal role in improving the conditions in which their members work. I know we will hear about some specific campaigns in the course of this debate this evening, but I want to highlight one last campaign, that of Unite the Union's Fair Hospitality, Get Me Home Safe. Employers have a responsibility to ensure their workers, those responsible for the functioning and success of their services or businesses, are safe as they make their way home after work. I am proud of the record of Scottish Greens in delivering positive change for workers across Scotland through our work with the Scottish Government over the last couple of years, particularly on Fair Work. But we have so much more to do. We need to challenge the wealthy and elite to deliver a fair and just world. We need to turn the world upside down. And I will end, Presiding Officer, with a short extract from that folk song, The World Turned Upside Down. You poor take courage, you rich take care. This earth was made a common treasury for everyone to share. All things in common, all people one. We come in peace. Thank you.
Thank you, Ms Chapman. We now move to the open debate. I call first Bill Kidd to be followed by Stephen Kerr at around 4 minutes. Mr Kidd.
Thank you very much, Presiding Officer, and I'd like to thank our colleague Maggie Chapman, MSP, for bringing forward tonight's important debate. It's a credit to our colleague and to this Parliament that in the week when we remember the contribution of workers and the trade union movement in their fight for better working conditions, respect and dignity, we are having concurrent members' debates on the importance of those individuals and groups to the historic establishment of workers' rights and their continuing struggle to not only maintain them, but to better them for the future. And the old adage, mourn for the dead, but fight for the living, unfortunately continues to be relevant today. Last night we touched on many of the issues that are relevant to today's debate, including paying tribute to those who furthered these rights and also the work done by the FBU, in particular in modernising and responding to new threats through their DECON campaign and the GMB with their Breathe Easy campaign to assist their welding members have a longer, healthier later life. New threats to workers' health and indeed the right to fair work are ever constant. And it's fitting that this year's Workers' Memorial Day was on the theme, the climate crisis and workers' health. For as the climate crisis worsens, changing weather patterns have notable effects on the world of work, particularly affecting workers' welfare, safety and health. Examples of occupational risks exacerbated by climate change include heat stress, UV radiation, air pollution, major industrial accidents, extreme weather events, and increased exposure to particulates and chemicals. These and other examples show us how workers' rights and our safety laws show, as I said yesterday and 2 seconds ago, the need to evolve to keep pace with change. Trade union membership is currently over 644,000 in Scotland, and they represent a hugely important collective force in ensuring positive change now and into the future. They are welcomed by the great majority of us as a positive influence within Scottish society, and representing over 555,000 of these workers, the STUC stands out as a positive, forward-thinking champion for workers' rights nationally and internationally, and I put it on record my thanks to all those involved in ensuring that the voice of Scotland's workers is heard. Recently, the STC has called for employment law to be devolved and have been instrumental in successfully moving a motion at the TUC General Council calling for the TUC General Council to campaign for the devolution of employment law to Scotland. In addition to repealing all Tory anti-trade union laws, including the Strikes Bill and the Trade Union Act 2016, a position supported by the Scottish Government and Scottish Labour, whose support we welcome. Yesterday, I echoed these calls for health and safety law to be devolved, as did the Minister for Energy, Just Transition and Fair Work. I hope that this was an issue that all parliamentarians could get behind. I still do, and I believe that we're okay there. So thank you very much, Presiding Officer.
Thank you, Mr Kidd. I now call Stephen Kerr to be followed by Richard Leonard, around 4 minutes. Mr Kerr.
Well, it's a pleasure to follow Bill Kidd, and I join in paying tribute to those who serve in our Fire and Rescue Service as we approach International Firefighters Day, and I humbly acknowledge their service and sacrifice. My dad was a butcher. He worked for the Co-op and Forfar. My mother was a shop worker. My grandparents were factory workers and tenant farmers. So I know about the immense good that can be achieved by the trade union movement. And I don't even need my old friend Richard Leonard to drum it into me about the importance and the need to protect workers. I'm there already. So I rise in this debate to praise trade unionism. There's a lot to be said in praise of pragmatic, collaborative and constructive the leadership that we see in many trade unions today. But one of the features of life in this country when I was a boy was negative and belligerent trade unionism. Union leaders driven by an anti-capitalist ideology. They saw themselves as being in the business of overthrowing the system and thought of themselves as being more politically powerful than the elected governments of the day, boasting of holding the government hostage to their demands. Their own political ends were often to the detriment of the best interests of their members. And the nadir of that kind of militant trade unionism was the travesty of the Ford manufacturing investment in Dundee in 1988, when 1,000 jobs would have been secured by major investment, but the GMB would not agree to a single union agreement, and the whole investment was lost. But in recent decades, particularly after the necessary trade union reforms of the 1980s and 1990s, the culture of trade unionism and its leadership has had to adapt and change. In 1982, we saw the end of the compulsory closed shop. In 1984, the need for a ballot before industrial action. In 1990, the need for a postal secure independent ballot. In 1992, again, the opt-in to the political levy rather than the opt-out. And then, as already mentioned, in 2016, we saw a requirement for minimum turnouts to validate a strike ballot. And these measures have been supported by successive governments, the 2016 Act standing aside, and have proved to be so popular with the public that no Labour government has ever attempted to repeal them. And as a result, trade unions have become a key component of the phenomenal job-creating machine which is the modern British economy. So when I listen to Angela Rayner promise to repeal trade union laws, I worry that we could see ourselves going back to the days of negative trade unionism. Today's economy is characterised by technological advancements, global competition, and the shift towards service-based industries. And the trade unions have recognised, to their credit, that the rigid union structures of the 60s and 70s can hinder the interests of their members, as well as stymie growth and job creation. The fact is that in survey after survey, it has been shown that when this country has voted for Conservative governments, so have the members of trade unions. Trade unions will continue to evolve in the era of automation, robotics, machine learning and AI, and they will adapt to the realities of the modern economy, where we must embrace constant change and reform and recognise that it is on the basis of cooperation and innovation and reform that we will see economic growth, increasing productivity, rising standards of living and more equality of opportunity for all. Thank you.
Thank you, Mr Kerr. I now call Richard Leonard to be followed by Ariane Burgess. Around 4 minutes, Mr Leonard.
Thank you, Deputy Presiding Officer. And can I thank Maggie Chapman for bringing forward this special debate? And can I remind members of my voluntary register of trade union interests? Well, freedom of association is a basic human right. Trade unions are not just about wages. They do have a political character. May Day, Chicago, 1886 and the Haymarket Square massacre is a reminder that it wasn't higher wages, it was shorter hours. It was the fight for the eight-hour day that lies at the very root of the modern trade union movement. Go and look at the slogans on the old trade union banners. Shorter hours and longer life. Out of darkness, into light. The cause of labour is the hope of the world. So I come here tonight to reaffirm my faith and my belief in the value of trade unionism as a force for good in society. It's where I had my real education. It's where I had many of my values shaped. It's where I worked with some of the finest women and men I have ever met. Workplace shop stewards, the very lifeblood of the trade union movement. I have much to be thankful for. And it's that experience which led me to the conclusion that trade unions are at their best when they do not simply strive to get the best deal for their members from the current economic and social system, but when they strive to fundamentally change the current economic and social system. It was Sidney Hill of Newpey who once famously said that trade unions are not fruit machines in which you put in money in the hope of winning a jackpot. Unions should be organs of social and economic change to end alienation, to end exploitation, because as long as they exist, conflict is inevitable. So when workers vote to take industrial action, in my book, you don't have a debate about whether to support them or not. You get right in behind them 100%. And what is surprising to me is not that we have had strikes in the last year on the railway, in our colleges, at Scottish Water, across both the public and private sector. It is that we have not had more of them, that they are not more prevalent. Of course, most trade unions have horizons way beyond collective bargaining alone. Radical aims, which are ethical, legal, political and social. A reconstruction of the existing social order. Economic reconstruction, so that we have an economy working for the needs of the people instead of people simply working for the needs of the economy. The establishment of industrial democracy and of workers' control, the humanisation of work, the elimination of gross inequalities, not just in the standard of living, but in the quality of life, and so a redistribution of not just wealth, but power. Now, finally, I'm just finishing up. Finally, at the weekend, we will mark May Day by taking to the streets. In so doing, we will be demonstrating that we are part of a world wide movement, that we know that the same people exploiting workers in the sweatshops of the Far East, taking away their rights on the construction sites of the Gulf, are exploiting workers and are taking away their rights right across the world. So that we know that we must look beyond nationalism, that we must look beyond wages, that we must look beyond the industrial struggle alone and understand that there is a world to win. It is a world that we have it in our own hands to create. If only we have the will, if only we have the courage,
if only we have the determination to stand firm and see it through.
Thank you, Mr Leonard. I now call Ariane Burgess to be followed by Carol Mock in around 4 minutes. Ms Burgess.
Presiding officer, I am pleased to speak in this debate brought by my colleague Maggie Chapman, recognising International Workers' Memorial Day and International Firefighters' Day. Every May Day, we celebrate and honour the immense contributions that workers and trade unions have made to building a fairer, more just Scotland. They have been at the forefront of securing vital rights and protections, from workplace safety standards to fair wages to collective bargaining. As legislators, it is our duty to make all work safer and healthier. We remember the dead and fight for the living to ensure that no one leaves for work and does not come home. Trade unions give workers a powerful voice and platform to advocate for their rights and interests. This is especially critical in sectors like social care, where predominantly female and underpaid workforces have long battled for better pay and conditions through their unions. And that's why last year, while in government, the Scottish Greens raised the wages of adult social care and childcare staff to at least £12 an hour across the social care sector. This is especially vital in rural Scotland, where more care workers are needed to support our ageing and dispersed population. In many rural areas, like those I represent, the public sector is the largest employer, with trade unions representing teachers, council workers, NHS staff, and more. And that's why cuts to public services are cuts to rural economies and communities. That's why I'm proud that during this year's budget negotiations, the Scottish Greens secured an additional £1.5 billion for public services and the workers who deliver them. The extra funds raised through progressive tax reforms are supporting fair pay rises. We fought tirelessly for this investment because we value our public sector workers, but we can and must do more. Last summer, I spoke with firefighters at the Parliament and in my region to discuss their days spent battling wildfires, a situation Highland residents are told they are currently at severe risk of facing again. Increasingly, the work of our firefighters is tackling flooding and wildfires exacerbated by extreme weather. Yesterday, Deputy Chief Officer Stuart Stevens said, "We expect climate change to intensify and present further challenges that we must be prepared to meet. Our depleted natural environment and extraction of its resources, as well as the climate crisis, are adding to the dangers they face. We must redouble our efforts to address global heating and consider how we manage our land to increase its resilience and adaptation to our changing climate." Presiding officer, progressive tax reforms pushed by the Scottish Greens means more money for our vital services and the valued workers who staff them. From caring for our loved ones, to teaching our young people, to keeping our communities safe, our public sector workers are the backbone of society. On this May Day, let us reaffirm our unwavering support for their rights, their working conditions and their unions.
Thank you, Ms Burgess. I now call Carol Mochan, last speaker in the open debate, around 4 minutes. Ms Mochan.
Thank you, Presiding Officer. And can I, of course, thank Maggie Chapman for bringing this important debate to the Chamber. And I agree with Bill Kidd that what is not to like about another evening where we get the opportunity to talk about the work, the benefit and the importance of the trade union movement. I have attended May Day events since I was about 15 years old, and I now march with my own children to mark this important Labour Day and to help my children understand why we need that solidarity in our communities to this very day. Can I note my register of interest as a lifelong member of the trade union movement, currently a Unite member and convener of the CWU Parliamentary Group? I want to start by saying that I wholeheartedly agree with Maggie Chapman's motion brought here to the Chamber today. Observing these days to remember workers is important. To raise the voices of workers is important. And to bring these things to our Parliament and speak about them in this Chamber is our duty as MSPs, particularly from the Labour benches. Those of us born within the trade union movement have a responsibility to bring this to this Parliament. Can I thank the member for her work with the Fire Brigades Union? And I know that she has worked really hard to support all manners of workers' rights within the firefighting services. And the DECON campaign in particular, I know she has championed and continues to do so. And it is much appreciated across the trade union movement. As we have heard, trade unions started a number of years ago. They started with the industrialisation of the late 18th and 19th centuries, which meant thousands of workers needed to move to towns and cities to live and work in poverty. The success of British industry in the 100 years from 1780 was built on the exploitation of hundreds of thousands of workers who worked, as we've heard, long days. They had miserable wages and they lived in very poor standards of accommodation. Workers realised they could only fight ruthless employers and inhumane working conditions by coming together. And so trade unions were born. Trade unions were fiercely opposed by owners of industry. And when I was researching for this speech, I thought to myself, I fear that perhaps we have elements of government now and of big business today that continue to fear the trade unions and oppose them. And we must continue the struggle that started hundreds of years ago. The most celebrated pioneers of British trade unionism, perhaps the first who organised, are the Toll Puddle Martyrs, six of the Dorset farm labourers who were eventually deported, people will know, for joining or creating a trade union. And I've read a lot about them, but I would sometime like to attend the festival which celebrates these brave workers who realised coming together and working in solidarity would yield results. For many of us in the trade union movement, we realise it is not frequently that we get results, but many of the members tonight have spoken about coming together and getting results. I'm running out of time, but I do want to just mention that if people enjoy May Day as a celebration of trade union activism, then they must attend the Durham Miners' Gala. The Durham Miners' Gala, in my view, is one of the finest dates on the trade union calendar, a time to be proud of our movement and to stand next to so many trade unionists and activists who work relentlessly to ensure we fight for what is right. Since 1871, Durham Miners' Gala has celebrated trade union collectivism, community spirit and that international solidarity that so many people have spoken about. And it gets bigger and better every year. So if you get the chance, please go. And a quote from the gala is, "The past we inherit and the future we build. Solidarity with the workers." Thank you, Presiding Officer.
Thank you, Ms Mochan. I now call on Richard Lockhart to wind up the debate around 7 minutes, Minister.
Thank you, Deputy Presiding Officer. I obviously want to start by thanking Maggie Chapman for bringing this motion forward and to all the members for their thoughtful and powerful contributions. And I too am proud to join others today in highlighting the significance of International Workers' Memorial Day, or May Day as we call it, or Labour Day as they call it in many countries around the world. To commemorate the historic struggles and the achievements of workers and the trade union movement globally. And as we've heard, this was first recognised in the late 1800s, and May Day was initially intended as a one-off protest for workers' rights to an eight-hour day. And I would gently point out to Stephen Kerr, in response to his comments, that back then, many countries did not have universal suffrage, and therefore when he talks about militancy against elected governments, in many countries there wasn't universal suffrage, so they couldn't elect the governments or deselect them. And also, going back in time, of course, the factory bosses and landowners comprised many of the politicians, and therefore that's why the solidarity was required. But I'll take an intervention.
Stephen Kerr.
I'm grateful to the Minister for giving me. Just to clarify, I was referring to the experience of this country, not other countries. I understand that circumstances in other countries in the 70s and 80s were what they are. But in this country, I was describing what the reality was in the 1970s in particular.
Minister, I can give you the time back.
Yes, and even in this country, of course, in the 1800s, there wasn't universal suffrage, so it's just to put that in the record. Now, these brave and also tragic acts of this protest that I referred to and others referred to, alongside rising trade unionism, led to a major movement within Labour and workers' rights, and, of course, others have referred to the Haymarket massacre in Chicago. Although May Day hugely impacted the trade union movement, it also exposed the existence of these horrific working conditions that many members have referred to. So this commemoration gives us an opportunity in this country and internationally to recognise and commemorate those who unfortunately left for work and didn't come home. And in the debate in Parliament in relation to Mick McGahey and his legacy, I told my story, of course, from my family, which is my great-great-grandmother lost her father, husband and son in separate many accidents. And that's quite something when you think about it. And that was not uncommon, but it shows why we should be commemorating workers' rights, progress, and indeed the trade union movement and health and safety and the issues that have been mentioned by members. It's also right that alongside May Day, we also recognise International Firefighters Day on the 4th of May. The Scottish Government, of course, recognises the bravery and dedication shown by firefighters on a daily basis to keep our community safe. Scotland, again, as we all know, has unfortunately experienced over history some tragic events which meant firefighters paid the ultimate price to save others. And International Firefighters Day gives us a chance to pause and reflect on those firefighters who have lost their lives and the impact on their family, friends and colleagues. And fighting fires and carrying out rescues, of course, is an inherently risky undertaking, but in working with the Scottish Fire and Rescue Service and its predecessor services, the Fire Brigades Union, FBU, which was also referred to in the motion, have been central in developing safe systems of work to reduce that risk. And most recently, the FBU has been at the forefront of campaigning to reduce the risk of contaminants being harmful to firefighter health. And I'm pleased that our Fire and Rescue Service here in Scotland is now taking this very seriously and adapting their systems of work, along with using the £10 million capital funding that was allocated this year to invest in fleets, equipment and buildings to help address this particular issue as well. So we also absolutely recognise the impact May Day has had on the trade union movement and workers' rights. And the motion makes specific references to the FBU, rightly so, in the context of International Firefighters Day. But in the broader context of May Day, we should, of course, pay tribute to vital work the wider trade union movement has played in improving worker safety. And it's also important to recognise the positive impact employer and trade union partnerships have in creating more progressive, productive, safer and engaged worker environments. So that's perhaps one area where I would agree with Stephen Kerr's, one of his points he made, and others as well. We also know in this country that fair work brings increased security and better physical health and greater psychological well-being for workers. We know it provides a more engaged, committed and adaptable workforce. So fair work, our policy in Scotland, is good for the economy and it drives productivity and it releases untapped potential and inspires innovation. And we know that effective voices is a critical dimension of fair work at a collective level, and trade unions, of course, can help workers to ascertain better terms and conditions. And that's why we continue to promote trade union recognition and collective bargaining to achieve these improved conditions and enhance effective voices. And that's, of course, an important step in our overall policy of Scotland being a fair work nation in 2025. Briefly?
Stephen Kerr.
So why doesn't the Scottish Government insist that all of the companies that are within its portfolio, such as Prestwick Airport, why doesn't it insist that they pay the real living wage? I'm a great believer in the real living wage. Why doesn't the Scottish Government believe in it?
Minister.
We do believe in the real living wage, and again, some of the opposition from some of his own members in terms of the conditionality sometimes we are looking at attaching. We are promoting that in Scotland in a very, very good place compared to the rest of the UK in terms of real living wage being paid to the proportion of employees in our country, and we should be proud of that, and that shows great progress. So with the top part of the UK when it comes to paying the real living wage. Now, in terms of the relevant powers this Parliament has that Maggie Chapman referred to, we're doing all we can to drive that fair work agenda and strengthen the voice of our workers. And it's why these organisations receiving Scottish Government grants now need to provide that appropriate channels for effective worker voices, as well as paying at least that real living wage as well, so that workers are treated fairly with dignity and respect. So I'll just close by saying that we look forward to working with our partnership with the Scottish Trade Union Congress, and we want to use days like today to commemorate, as members have done, the ultimate sacrifice that many workers have made down the generations, but also celebrate the progress that the trade union movement and workers have made in this country and across the world to further their own cause and make the world and workplaces a better place.
Thank you, Minister. That concludes the debate, and I close this meeting of Parliament.